Everyone, welcome to Upper Christian Church this morning. Do we have any birthdays to celebrate? Do we have any anniversaries to celebrate? If not, we'll continue on with the church. I can't talk, but J.H. had a birthday. So let's do the birthday salutation for J.H. Many happy returns on the day of thy birth. May sunshine and gladness be given. And may the dear Father prepare thee on earth for a beautiful birthday in heaven. Happy birthday, J.H. If there's nothing else, we'll continue on with the service.
All right, let's have everyone stand up. We'll sing our opening song. Get into our opening prayer. I just felt this was as good a time as any to do a little short announcement time because there's a lot of stuff going on. The most exciting thing, I guess, is the fact that I got the phone call. Trace Farthing, our new preacher, and Christy and I had a phone conversation this Wednesday or Thursday. It was a busy week, but anyway, they're planning on coming between October 5th and the 7th. That's midweek. The 5th is a Tuesday. He's planning on coming at that time so that they can get unpacked and he could be ready to preach on the 10th, that following Sunday. So, great news. The time has finally come, the time we've been waiting for forever. That's the tentative plan right now, is between the 5th and 6th. He's excited to be here. He can't wait to get here. They both are. And just he told me a lot of plans already. We had over an hour conversation. So I can't wait till he gets here and is able to share a lot of his thoughts and ideas with you too. But along those lines, he's excited about coming to be here for the Harvest Festival too. And Joy has put a thing in the inside here to, for the date being Saturday, October 30th. That's a Saturday evening as opposed to having it on Sunday. So that we're just kind of kicking that around right now if that would be best. It seems to me it would be better to do something on a Saturday evening than Sunday night. So that way, but we need to know if we don't have anybody able to help on Saturday instead of Sunday, we might have to change that, but hopefully we don't. But anyway, think about that, discuss it, see how it works better. You know, we can have a separate night set aside for the church for a Harvest Festival. It's not Halloween, but you know what? We're here to reach them people out there. That's what we talked about last Sunday, right? That's why we're here. So hopefully it works, and we can get people together to do that. All right, let me do a prayer. I think that, oh no, there's a couple other things. Just a lot of good things happening here. Next Saturday is the women's, the ladies, how do I want to describe that? Let Gail do it. She's doing it.
So we're really excited to have Dr. Anna Chaika come from Southeast Christian Counseling. We'll be speaking that night. The title of the event is Extraordinary Love, and it kind of kicks off a study, a women's study that will start on God's love, how we love each other, just a lot of exploring. So there are posters in the back that if you would like to take one and put something up somewhere, there's inserts in the bulletin. Give one to a friend. Invite everybody to come Saturday night. And we have a potluck. It's 5 o'clock. So it'll be exciting.
And then November 6th is our last one. Not our last one, but another one. Last on my list for right now. And that's a food packing thing where we're going to come together as church and community and pack food for Haiti. And I think Rebecca has some flyers made up on that she's going to bring, kind of showing, you know, what all gets put together for these people. We did this once here as a church. It was an awesome time. You get together with a bunch of people, and you're at a station, and I put dry peas or whatever it is. I put whatever I put into the bag, you know, and it's just a lot of fun. We had a great time doing that. So it's an opportunity also to serve here. So that's all I got. So I'm going to pray, and then we'll get back into our worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day, Lord. We're just grateful to be here. What an opportunity to come in and worship you, Lord, and give you the praise and glory and honor that you so justly deserve. Father, we just ask that you be with everybody's heart this morning and open it up to hear your word and hear the music and just become invigorated with life, with Jesus. And may we take that opportunity to go out and share it in this world. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Savior.
Christ's cleansing power we believe. How he made the lame to walk again, and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus
Genesis 21, I'll be reading verses 22 through 34. And it came to pass at that time that Abimelech and Phicol, the chief captain of his host, spake unto Abraham, saying, God is with thee in all that thou doest. Now therefore swear unto me here by God that thou wilt not deal falsely with me, nor with my son, nor with my son's son, but according to the kindness that I have done unto thee, that thou shalt do unto me and to the land wherein thou hast sojourned. And Abraham said, I will swear. And Abraham reproved Abimelech because of a well of water, which Abimelech's servants had violently taken away. And Abimelech said, I wot not what thou hast done, what hath done this thing, neither didst thou tell me, neither yet heard I of it, but today. And Abraham took sheep and oxen and gave them to Abimelech, and both of them made a covenant. And Abraham set 7 ewe lambs of the flock by themselves. And Abimelech said unto Abraham, what mean these 7 ewe lambs, and thou hast set by themselves?
Abraham said, "For these seven ewe lambs shalt thou take of my hand, that they may be a witness unto me that I have digged this well." Wherefore he called that place Beersheba, because there they swore, both of them. Thus they made a covenant at Beersheba. Then Abimelech rose up, and Phicol, the chief captain of his host, and they returned to the land of the Philistines. And Abraham planted a grove in Beersheba and called there on the name of the Lord, the everlasting God. And Abraham sojourned in the Philistine land many days. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
May I be like you.
This morning for our communion meditation, I want you to remember one word, and that's remember. That's a tough thing for a lot of us to do, is to remember. And I think that's why it's so important that we have communion on a weekly basis, because we struggle with remembering. How many remember what we talked about last Sunday? Probably a few. But if I mention the word salt and light, how many remember what we talked about last Sunday? Probably a whole lot more of you do. So there's things that we need to do to help us to remember. There are many malls around that house a store called Things Remembered, which offers items that can be engraved to commemorate special occasions. If you have received such a gift, you know what a treasure it can become. People like to remember happy times and significant events in their lives. Memories are precious. They keep us connected to people, to places, and to events that have shaped us and influenced our lives. At the Last Supper, Jesus shared a meal with his disciples and then led them in the observance of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, or Passover. Jesus, the master teacher, used this opportunity to plant an important memory in his disciples gathered in that upper room. Jesus shared this meal for their benefit and for ours. As Jesus raised the bread in the cup for Thanksgiving, he added new significance to this ancient ritual. I'm going to read you the passage out of Luke 22, verses 14 through 20, which pertain to when Jesus was with the disciples. And when the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, "With desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it amongst yourselves. For I say unto you that I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come." And he took bread, gave thanks and brake it, and gave unto them, saying, "This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you." Jesus took an old symbol and filled it with new meaning. The meaning of Jesus' words and actions is rooted in his command to remember. While their remembrance is historical, it is also personal. Jesus doesn't ask us to remember that date, that place, etc. What does Jesus ask us to remember? Him. He doesn't ask us to remember his death. He says, "Do this in remembrance of me," to remember him. Our relationship with Christ is a personal one. Remember the gracious love of our Father in heaven, who made us children of his own possessions. Remember Jesus Christ, sent by the Father, to share our human nature, to live and to die as one of us, and so to move us from the alienation of sin and death, to reconcile us to God our Father by his perfect sacrifice and through his suffering, death, and resurrection, to save all that put their trust in him. And lastly, remember the Holy Spirit, who teaches us these things and makes the effects of Christ's salvation real in our lives. Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, we tend to be forgetful people. And so to honor Christ, we do as he commanded. We have this brief ceremony to simply remember him, to remember his giving up his heavenly glory for a time, living as a man, enduring a horrible death, and worst of all, enduring separation from you as he took our sin upon himself. So, Father, even though we do this on a regular basis, and we remember Christ, I pray that it would never become routine, that each time we do this and each day of our lives, we would remember his sacrifice, that it was his sacrifice that purchased our salvation and our hope of eternal life with you. May we be a blessing to you now as we remember your son. It's in his name that I pray. Amen.
Lord God in heaven, we come before you at this time to return a small portion of what you have so richly blessed each and every one of us with. We thank you for our jobs that we are able to survive in this world financially, and we ask that you bless the gift and the giver for the furtherance of this church in this area, and we ask your blessing upon Trace and his wife as they get ready to come to share his love and his knowledge of you with the rest of us. In the most holy name I pray, amen.
There's nothing in the world that could ever take the place of God's love. Silver and gold could never buy his love from above. When my soul is healing and I begin to feel in his power, say thank you, Lord, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. Well, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. I've got to make it to heaven somehow. Though the devil tempts me and he tries to turn me around, he's offered everything that's got a name. All the wealth I want and worldly fame. If I could still, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. Out traveling for the Lord many years ago, had a lot of heartache, met a lot of grief and woe. When I would stumble, then I would humble down. wouldn't say I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now.
Well, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. I've got to make it to heaven somehow. Though the devil tempts me and he tries to turn me around. He's offered everything that's got a name. All the wealth I want and worldly fame. If I could still, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. No, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. I've got to make it to heaven somehow. Though the devil tempts me and he tries to turn me around. He's offered everything that's got a name. All the wealth I want and worldly fame. If I could still, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. If I could still, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now.
Prayer time. I didn't write down a lot of the prayers, Dallas. So if I need to or whatever, I'll hopefully try and remember the ones that we went through. A lot of the ones we went through during Sunday school this morning, because we had a fair number of prayers. As Dallas said this morning, backs seem to be up there in our prayer list. There's a lot of hurting backs. The biggest praise is this man sitting right up here in the second row right here, who we prayed for a long time. And we heard that he wasn't coming today because he couldn't get in the truck. So we prayed for him, and he came in before we finished praying practically. So God does amazing things. Got him here. So that's a good thing. We're very thankful to see you again, Thurston. Thank you for your voice and just everything, just good to hear from you.
Each and every one for all prayers. I felt every one of them. And yes, that was some dark times, but by God's grace, light is coming, light is shining again.
Amen. Amen. And we prayed for Kay. Kay is having some back problems too, and she's doing better because she's here. But also, she needs continued prayer for her back. And then our brother J.H. also is going to be going into back surgery here whenever he can get that scheduled. His back is bothering him, so we need to be in prayer for J.H. too and his back. We're thankful that he's back with us after being gone for, he told me it's been almost 5 weeks too. So, yes, time flies when they're not here amongst us. So we're thankful, though, that he's back too. Other things that we prayed about. What was it? Help me, guys, because I know that got a lot of things on my mind. The main one. Their main reason this row up here is full this morning. We're going to have a baptism later today, an exciting thing. And we're so thankful for that. And I know you're excited. We need to pray for our brother Mark, wherever he's hiding now. Because he's going to be doing that for Colby, and so we want to be with all of them and definitely give him this is what he's been doing for the last 2 weeks. I think he's a little bit excited. There's Mark back there, but he's practicing, I guess. No, but no, we're excited about that. So that's what we're here for, right? Yep, absolutely. What are some of the any others that I need to mention at this time?
Granddaughter and great-granddaughter.
Oh, yes, Alan and Beverly's daughter and granddaughter. Granddaughter and great-granddaughter. Granddaughter and great-granddaughter have COVID currently at this time, so for just to help them get through that and then they built up their immunities. Any others? Yeah, I want to lift up a good friend of mine who's been really trying to get here for a long time, and he's lived over here in this parsonage for 2 years, Rich Weininger. I've had the opportunities to spend a lot of time with Rich over the last couple weeks, and he is he's got some major health issues, and then he's got problems, lots of problems within his family and monetary and And we just need to pray for Rich. We need to pray God into his life to help him through a lot of these difficult situations he's been going through for a long, long time. But I think we'll go with anything else that somebody wants to specify. Otherwise, we'll go to God in prayer here. Okay, let's go to God. Let's go to him in prayer. Father in heaven, we're just so thankful that we have a God who hears us. As we'll hear shortly here this morning, the living God. Father, you're a God that lives within us, within our hearts, within our souls, and within our minds. Father, we're just truly thankful that we can freely come to you and speak to you, and you hear our voice. Father, you know our hearts before we speak them. And yes, there's many prayers here probably this morning that have gone unspoken, and you know them, and we lift them up to you now at this time, Lord. Lord, we want to especially bring to attention the things that are first and foremost in our hearts right now. And number one, Kobe's baptism this morning. What an exciting thing to bring another person to you, Father. That is our mission here on this earth, is to seek and save those that are lost and bring them to you. What an exciting moment for him, his family, and for all of us here too. Father, I just pray that as this journey begins for him, that we come along beside him and continually lift him up. And because yes, there will be those times when Satan tries to tear us down, but that's what we're here for, is to help each other along the way. Father, we're thankful for healing in Thurston, and can pray that you continue to heal and strengthen him as he moves along. And he's just truly grateful for all the good things that have come from this. I know it was a tough decision for many years in his life, and we're just glad that this back surgery has worked for him, and we just pray for continued strength. And for Kay also, pray for strength in her back, and pray, Lord, that you will take that away. We know that you have that power. Father, we just want to be in prayer for J.H. as he gets ready to enter into this back surgery procedure. May the timing be good. I know he's only good, he said, for like another 4 or 5 weeks, and then the pain is going to be back pretty bad. So, Father, I just pray that that you expedite this time to get this surgery done, that he's able to get in and get it taken care of, and be on a healing path here. Father, there's just many things in our lives that we're just so thankful for, that you have blessed us with, and that we tend to forget on a daily basis. But that's where that word remember comes in. Just as we talk to you, it will help us to remember what we need to be talking to you about. As we go forth with this service, Father, I just pray that all our hearts be opened up to the words that Brother Dallas has gotten from you, and that they may touch us in a way that help us to go out and share you with this world. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
If y'all get a chance later, be sure and thank Dale for all the work he's done over at the Parsonage. It is awesome. I had the opportunity to be over there yesterday, and for those of you that took the what do we call it, a field trip a few weeks ago, and went over there and looked. If you want to go over after service today and look, it's a whole different place. And I know there's been other people that have been over there helping, but Dale's been rodding the whole thing.
Denise helped paint. I'm probably going to forget names now, but there was other people that have helped, and I'm truly thankful for the help that we got. Quentin helped. Dallas helped tear out. We tore out carpet yesterday. So, I mean, it's been a continual process. It hasn't all been me. I'm thankful for all the help that I've gotten.
Okay. Here we go. I was a little bit touched with what Dale said about our mission here on earth was to bring others to Christ in his prayer. And it kind of goes along with something I was thinking. We're on a mission. We're not here permanently, right? We're here for a mission. And I was walking around yesterday. I had some shopping to do. Rebecca was coming back from her business trip, and so I did some shopping before I picked her up at the airport. And so I was at a, I won't name any names specifically, but I was at one store that rhymes with Onco, and it was interesting being in there. And then later we went to a couple shops in Aurora, and just watching people and the way they're dressed and the things they have on their face, and I really got the impression I really didn't belong, right? And I really felt like I was an alien in a different location, that this really wasn't home. And then it kind of hit me, you know what? It's not. This isn't supposed to be home. Our home is elsewhere. And our job here, our mission, as Dale just prayed, is to bring as many people back home with us as we can. And so that's neat how that tied in with me. But it's not often that I feel out of place. But boy, yesterday, for some reason, I really felt out of place at some of those locations. Well, as promised, a few weeks ago, I said the remaining times that I would be in front of you before Trace got here, we'd be going through the names of God. And so we're going to do that, the next one in the line today. But just briefly, remember, the first one we had was Elohim, El being the all-powerful creator God, and Ohim given the plural of that, given the indication that Jesus and the Holy Spirit were present at the time of creation. It's pretty interesting thought and discussion with that. Next one, El Roi, the God who sees me. El Shaddai, a couple weeks ago, the God Almighty, the covenant God, the God who wants to create, enter into a covenant with us. Today we're going with El again, El with that all-powerful creator God idea. But there's always a descriptive term that goes with that, and this one is Olam, which goes along with Olam meaning eternal or forever or lasting, everlasting. And so when we put that together, we have El Olam, which is the everlasting God, the eternal God. And it specifically, when it's used in Scripture, applies to God and His law, that they're everlasting, they're eternal. God and His promises being everlasting and eternal. God and His covenant with us being everlasting and eternal. And God and His kingdom being everlasting and eternal. Now, there's enough stuff in those four words talking about those being everlasting. Fred's going to give me a hard time. We could probably get through it in 2 or 3 weeks. Maybe a little bit longer than that. But there's a lot there when we think about the everlasting God applying to His laws and His promises and His covenant and His kingdom. There's a lot there. But we won't go down that road today. We're going to have to try and finish. But just think about that if you want to do some study on that, what that really means, that His laws and His promises, His covenant and His kingdom is eternal. It's everlasting. It's pretty awesome when we think about it. Dale read in the scripture reading this morning in Genesis chapter 21. We're going to start there. We're going to jump around a little bit today to some different scriptures, but we're going to start there. And that whole story about the treaty at Beersheba between Abraham and Abimelech and Phicol is an interesting one. And I think one of the first thing that jumps out of me with that story is that they come to Abraham and they say, in verse 22, God is with you in everything you do. Now swear to me here before God that you will not deal falsely with me or my children and my descendants. Show me and the country where you are living as an alien the same kindness I have shown you. So I think it's interesting here that Abimelech is aware and notices that God is blessing Abraham. Everything that Abraham touches is doing well. And Abimelech is crediting that to God, saying that God is with you in everything that you do. And so you see a little bit of a politician here, right? He's the leader of the Philistines here. A little bit of a politician. I'm going to make sure that this guy, that everything's going well for, that God's on his side, that we have a good agreement with him, right? So we have that desire to have that treaty or that agreement, that covenant between Abimelech and Abraham. But so my question to you, as you go through your life, are there people that don't know God? Are they able to look at you and see God? That God is in you, that God's blessing you, that you're giving all the credit and praise to God that you can, like Abraham was? Because that's what drew Abimelech to start this treaty, was Abraham was being blessed and he was giving credit to God, and Abimelech noticed that. So are we following in Abraham's footsteps when God blesses us? Do we praise him? Do we let people know that, hey, God's a great God, he's taking care of us, whether it's in health and our finances and our relationships, whatever it may be, that God is taking care of us? And that's what drew Abimelech to have this conversation with Abraham. We skip to the end of that passage, down around 32. So after the treaty had been made at Beersheba, Abimelech and Phicol, the commander of his forces, returned to the land of the Philistines. And if you know anything about the Old Testament and the Genesis, they were big on symbols, right? They loved their symbols. They liked to commemorate things. And so Abraham did that. And Abraham, in verse 33, says, Abraham planted a tamarisk tree in Beersheba, and there he called upon the name of the Lord, and here's where we get our name today, El Olam. He called upon the name of the Lord, the eternal God, and Abraham stayed in the land of the Philistines for a long time. So we have this well at Beersheba, this well of oath. And to commemorate this treaty, this covenant between Abimelech and Abraham, he planted a tamarisk tree here. And there are some interesting things that goes along with this treaty, of why it looks like why Abraham used a tamarisk tree to commemorate this treaty. The tamarisk tree is known for its long life. It lives a long time. So it was a symbol that this treaty between Abimelech and Abraham was going to be a long time. The tamarisk tree produces thousands and thousands of seeds. So there's a lot of seeds that is provided from one tree. And the tamarisk tree needs a lot of water. It's one of those trees that takes a lot of water. And so we can see that this well must have been a very good producing well for this to be able to grow the tamarisk tree. And it became a symbol of this oath and this promise, this treaty between Abimelech and Abraham. And fully knowing when Abraham planted this tree that the tree would outlast him. And part of the treaty was, if you look back there in the first part, that's Abimelech's desire that this treaty carries on, right? That it doesn't, it's not just for today or this week or this month. It's going to be a long-lasting treaty between these two, and Abraham shows that and commemorates that with this symbol of a tamarisk tree. So that's where we're going to jump off in this, the first place in the Scripture where El Olam is used as far as the eternal God, the God that is everlasting. What an awesome thing that is. Later on in Scripture, it talks about it the same thing. Nehemiah, in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 9, verse 5, the Israelites have, they've, as they were, just like we are, get away from following God, and they were going their own way, and they found Scripture. And Ezra reads the law to them, and they realize that they have been not following what they should have been doing. They weren't following God as they should have. And so they have come to confess their sins and to be forgiven and reunite their pledge to follow God. And part of what Nehemiah says to them, and it's not Nehemiah, it's the Levites, the people who should be leading them spiritually, in chapter 9, verse 5, and the Levites, and there's several of them listed there, which I'm not going to pronounce, but there's about seven of them. And they said, listen to the point of it, stand up and praise the Lord your God, who was from everlasting to everlasting. Praise your God, who was from everlasting to everlasting. That's a hard concept for it, isn't it? Everlasting to everlasting. When Cody and I were coming down this morning, he knew we were on the names of God, and he asked me what we were what the topic was today, and I told him about God being eternal, everlasting, from beginning and end. He said, that's a hard one sometimes for me to understand. Well, you know what? It's a hard one for all of us to understand at times. When we think of God being always being and always will be, it's a hard concept for us to understand. And why is that? Well, everything that we do, everything that we experience in this life has a beginning and an ending, doesn't it? Everything that we experience in life, from the time that we're born or we see our children born, the beginning, isn't it? And we see the different stages that they go through. So there's an ending of one stage and a beginning of another stage, and the ending of that stage and the beginning of another one. And we see that throughout our lives. We have beginnings and endings throughout our life. We know we're going to have a beginning when we were born. We know we're going to have an ending when we die. And that's just the order of things. And even in the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon writes about it as well. In this beginning and an ending, and while we have a hard time understanding that. In chapter 3, verse 20, he writes here, "All go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return." And so we have that knowledge that there's always a beginning and there's an ending, right? And so when we try to apply that to God and see that there's no beginning, there's no ending, it's hard for our human brains to get a grasp of that, to understand it. But we have to understand it. We have to accept that. That's what Scripture says. And we accept it on faith that that's the way it is. In Psalm chapter 90, verse 3, and my Bible says that they believe this was a prayer from Moses. In verse 3, "You turn men back to dust, saying, 'Return to dust, O sons of men.'" You know what? That's something that we're all going to face, returning to dust, unless Jesus decides to come back before then. And we don't know when that is, and we don't know when our last day is. So we must be ready at all times of when that might take place. Some people are blessed with a long life. Some people we see that their lives are tragically cut short of what we would expect for their normal lifespan to be. And so we don't know when that time will be for us, but we need to be prepared of it. We've all heard stories of people who have lived a long life and had a blessed life. And in this book that I've been using as a basis for our discussions on the Word of God, there's a story in here about a lady, and I'm just going to read it to you because I found it very humorous, about how a long life can be a blessing and maybe not so much to some other people. Jean Calment was a French woman who took up fencing lessons. Now, I understand we're in a ranching area, but she wasn't out in the field putting up fences. She was using the fencing, okay? She took up fencing lessons at the age of 85 and rode her bike until she was 100, and she lived to be 122. She credited her long life to drinking port wine, I don't recommend it, a diet rich in olive oil, and her sense of humor. "I will die laughing," she predicted. And in fact, Jean had the last laugh when it came to a business deal she made when she was 90. So she was pretty smart businesswoman here. In 1965, a 47-year-old lawyer offered to purchase Jean's apartment. He agreed to pay her $500 a month for the rest of her life on the condition that the ownership of the apartment would immediately revert to him after her death. Now, he thought he had a pretty good deal here. She was 90 years old. $500 a month, that's a pretty safe bet. But his gamble must have seemed sure, but it never paid off. Though the lawyer lived to the respectable age of 77, Jean outfoxed him by living a year longer than he did. Over the course of 30 years, the lawyer paid Jean a total of $184,000. More than twice the market value of the apartment. And to add insult to injury, the heirs were obligated to continue to payments until her death. So, Be careful entering into business agreements with 90-year-old people. They've been around. They understand how to make it work in their favor. But even Jean, right? This lady that lived to 122, which that's a long time for us, right? We would be pretty impressed if anybody would be making it to 122 these days. There was still an ending, wasn't there? She had a beginning, and she had evidently a pretty eventful and fruitful life throughout that time, and had fun and a good sense of humor, as the story says. But even at that, there was an ending. There was an ending at that 122 years. So we must be ready. We don't know when or how our life here on this earth will end, but we always need to be ready. And so that's one reason why we have a hard time thinking about God and his always been here and always will be, because of our experience of there always being a beginning and ending with us. The other thing I think that impacts us, why we have a hard time with that concept, is we're an impatient people. Anybody guilty? Okay. You know, one of the fruit of the Spirit we're supposed to have is patience. Just throwing that out there. We're supposed to be a patient people. But you know what? Our society, we want things now, don't we? We want things now. Did they have fast food 100 years ago? No. But boy, we sure get impatient when there's two people in front of us in line at McDonald's, right? We want that food now. How many people ever sat in front of the microwave watching it going to town heating something up and say, boy, I wish this microwave would really hurry up, right? I can do popcorn in 3 minutes now. It's just too, I can't wait that long. I need it now, right? We're an impatient people. Or we're so impatient that we don't even want to take the time to go to a store anymore. We get on our phones or our computer and order it online so it can be here. And then we'll pay extra so it'll be here tomorrow. We don't want it to be here in 2 days. We want it to be here tomorrow. We're an impatient people. Even waiting in line. How many people just love waiting in line? Oh, no takers. That's a surprise. You know, Disney has capitalized on that nobody wants to wait in line. So when you go to one of their theme parks, you can pay extra to skip the line. Does anybody find any irony? Anyway, I just think it's interesting. You're already paying $100 to get through the front door, and you're going to pay another 100 or whatever it is just to skip the lines. They've got us figured out. We're an impatient people. We want things now. We want it to be happening now. And you know what else we want to have happen now? We want God to work now. It follows into our spiritual life, doesn't it? We want God to go to work now in the way that I want him to. God, don't you see everything that's happening in this world? Don't you see how wicked people are? Don't you see how they've turned their back on you? Come on, God, aren't you paying attention to what's going on? You need to act. Need to let some lightning bolts go. Isn't that our attitude sometimes? You know what God's response is to us? Yes, I see. I am the God El Roi. Remember our lesson from a while back? I am the God who sees. I am aware of what's going on. And he does know what we're facing and what's going on. But you know what? God does things on his own time. We were just in the book of Psalms in chapter 90 in verse 3, but if you continue on there, after us returning back to dust, O sons of men, verse 4 says, for 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or a watch in the night. God does things on his timetable, not on ours. You say, really? You think there's any examples of that? Yep. Israel was enslaved for generations in Egypt before God delivered them. Generations. Did he see their suffering? Did he see their hard work? Did he see everything that was going through? Yep. But they were still enslaved for generations. And on his timetable, he brought them out of that slavery. After that, and the prophecies of Christ that there would be a Savior come, the Jewish people waited hundreds of years for Christ. Those people that were so anxious and waiting and hoping that the Messiah, that Christ would come, When did they want it, that Messiah to come? Right now, right? Let's go. Let's get this show on the road. But at just the right time is when God sent his Messiah, when he sent Jesus to earth. It was on his timetable. See, we must be patient. And I know it's not easy at times. When we look at the world around us, we see the circumstances that we at times find ourselves in. It's hard to be patient. But we need to have that patience and that trust that God got it in control. And he does. God works on his timetable. And our job is to simply remain faithful to him. So those are two things I think we have a hard time understanding. This concept of God being eternal. He's always been and always will be. But you know what? There's some real benefits in having a God that is a forever God. We're going to go over a couple of those, maybe four of them here. We'll go over four. Some real benefits from having a forever God that we can serve. In Psalm chapter 9, verses 7 through 10, it's credited to David. It's one of the poems that he put together to be sung. Psalm chapter 9, 7 through 10. Now listen to this. This is the God that we're serving. This is the God that has saved us. This is the eternal God. The Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. He will judge the world in righteousness, and he will govern the people with justice. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Those who know your name will trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Boy, is that a benefit of serving a forever God? A God who's always been here and always will be? Yes, it is. And the book of Hebrews talks a little bit more about this, of God being consistent and always being here. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, says specifically, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. He doesn't change. He is always the same. Is that a benefit of having an eternal God, a forever God? Absolutely. He's consistent. He's always been here, always will be, and he's here for us now. In the book of 1 John, chapter 2, verse 17, John writes these words. The world and its desires pass away. And you understand that? The world and its desires will pass away. This world, the things that we think are important in this world, they're going to pass away. John says, the world and its desires will pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever. Now, that's pretty awesome, right? We're in a temporary place. I talked earlier about kind of feeling like I was out of place. I'm an alien sometimes. Although I think I look more normal than some of the people I saw over yesterday. They looked more alienicious to me. But I felt out of place, right? And there should be, because you know what? It says that world that I see around me where I don't feel comfortable being part of sometimes, and its desires are going to pass away. But the man who does the will of God will live forever. Awesome. And if you turn the page, that's a definite benefit of having a forever God. Turn the page into 1 John chapter 5, verse 3. And remember, he is consistent and constant. He's always will be and always has been. And in verse 3, this is what it says that we need to do to spend eternity with him. John says, this is love for God. This is how we show love for God. To obey his commands. And his commands are not burdensome, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Wow, is that a benefit of serving a forever God? Absolutely, absolutely. If I could have the singing group come forward. You know, the question becomes then, you know, how do I go about becoming the Son of God? And we're going to explore that in Sunday school over the next few weeks. And today we talked about sin and how sin separates us from God, that we've all sinned. There's nobody in this room that has not sinned. Whether you acknowledge it or not, that it was against God's laws, you know in your heart that you have sinned. Everybody has. And we went through the scriptures that show that the punishment, the wages of that sin is death. And it's not a physical death, it's that eternal death. And that if we continue to go down that road, it's a wide road and many are going to go down that way, but narrow is the road that leads to salvation. And what is that road? Well, we have that road of acknowledging that Jesus is the Christ. We have that belief and that conviction he is the Christ, he is the Messiah. We have that belief. We confess, we repent, turn away from our sins. We aren't going to do those anymore. We're baptized into him, into his death. And that's only the beginning. Those are only the first steps, right? After that, it's making that commitment that I'm going to live for him. This is no longer me living, but it's Christ living in me. And that's what sometimes is the most hard thing to get done. But we're going to enter into a time of invitation. Folks here are going to sing, and we'll have a good time here.
Let's stand up.
Would you live for Jesus and be always pure and good? Would you walk with him within the narrow road? Would you have him bear your burden, carry all your load? Let him have his way with thee. His power can make you what you ought to be. His blood can cleanse your heart and make you free. His love can fill your soul and you will see. 'Twas best for him to have his way with thee.
We're always excited to see him. A few weeks ago, Mark and Colby, am I on now? We talked about tying you up earlier. You don't remember that part? Okay. A few weeks ago, Mark and Colby came to me and said that Colby was interested in being baptized, and they would like to talk a little bit about that. You all can sit down. This might take a minute. And so we were got together, and we talked, and very impressed with this young man. He understands what he's doing today. He's a little quiet sometimes. That's normal. But we've been getting a lot of thumbs and thumbs up and good things going on. So we're on the right track there. So we're excited about that. But as we went through and we're studying on what baptism entails and what it means, and then we got done and said, you know, Colby, why do you want to do this? And he said, I want my sins to be forgiven. And said, that is awesome. And so we're going to have a baptism today, and that's exciting. And Mark's going to perform the baptism, which is exciting. Right? Okay. So, Colby, I just want to ask you a question. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God?
Yes.
Awesome. Awesome, awesome. So they are going to go to the back and get ready for this baptism. And in the meantime, if we could get some young, shorter people, young guys to come up here and we'll get the, yep, you're good to go. Grab the pulpit and the communion table and make some space here so we can see. I'm going to read some scriptures. There's a lot of scriptures that you can read when you start talking about baptism and all of its meanings. But one of my favorites is to share with people a parable that Jesus gave to people that leads us to some questions. And it's in the book of Matthew, if you want to follow along. It's in chapter 22, in verse 1. It says, Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted calf have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servant, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to the servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find. So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. Friend, he asked, how did you get in here without wedding clothes? The man was speechless, and the king told the attendant, tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are invited, but few are chosen. So we have this parable, and we can see that it's an earthly story given a spiritual message. And so we have this this thought, this idea, and we see that this is talking about heaven, right, and that the God is the one that's throwing the wedding banquet, and we see that the servants that he sent out were the prophets of old. And we see that they were mistreated, as the prophets were mistreated. And finally, he says, where the people, those people don't deserve to come, go find everybody. And you know what? That's a good thing, because you know what? We're all part of everybody. we're the everybody that got left out, that we're now have added to this wedding banquet, the wedding banquet representing heaven. But we see the king, the one who's throwing the wedding banquet, and this one is God, come to see the guests. Notice there was someone who wasn't wearing wedding clothes, wasn't properly dressed, didn't have the right things on, and got thrown out. And so we see this parable that someone got thrown out here because they didn't have the right clothes on. What's the question that's just begging there? What's the right clothing? Fred's got it right. How do I make sure that I've got the right clothes on, so that when this time comes of this wedding banquet of heaven, that I am properly dressed? Well, God doesn't put a question in the Bible that he doesn't answer. Okay? Jesus was the one who put this in there. And through his servant, Paul, in the book of Galatians, I believe this question is answered. How are we properly dressed for the wedding banquet that's to come? So in the book of Galatians in chapter 3, Paul is writing in verse 26. And he says, you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. Now, doesn't that just complete the picture there? How do we make sure we're clothed properly? We're clothed with Christ through baptism. And that's the symbol that we're going to be a witness of today. Guys, if you're ready. So, with that said, upon your confession in faith in Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, for sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Congratulations. Terrific. That's awesome. So stay around, greet Colby, new brother in Christ. How awesome is that? And so we're so excited for him, and we're so glad the family was here to witness that. It's awesome, and we're just excited for his decision, and young man, it's going places. We're excited. So I'm gonna have a prayer, and we'll close our service. Father in heaven, what a privilege it is to witness Colby making that decision for you. Father, in his understanding, knowing that it's not a one-time decision, but it's a decision he'll have to make over and over again to take up his cross and follow you just like the rest of us do. And Father, may we encourage him along the way. As we discussed in Sunday school, we know that when a person becomes serious about you, Satan becomes serious about them and will throw all kinds of roadblocks in front. And so, Father, I just pray for protection around Colby. Father, may we stand in the gap. May we be the ones who are there with him and fighting with Satan with our prayers and with Scripture. So, Father, I'm so excited that he's made this decision. Just pray that you'll bless him in that. And, Father, as Dale had mentioned earlier, this is our mission, and to bring others to Christ. And so, Father, I just pray that you'll give us the guidance and the wisdom, and Father, put the people in front of us that we can share the love of your Son with them, Father, and just let you go to work. Let you go to work on their hearts, Father, and let you do as you will. But, Father, we know our job is to spread the seed and help us to do that. Be with us now as we depart from here, that you give us safety, Father, that you give us the courage, you give us the determination to follow you, come what may. In the name of Christ, I pray. Amen.